So this is going to be our goal today, is to try to learn how to calculate these time order products of fields. They're sometimes called Green's functions or endpoint functions. So another notation that I'll use occasionally is denoting this function as g of the space-time points at which the fields are evaluated. And so we're going to learn how to calculate these quantities by doing perturbation theory. So we know how to calculate, if we didn't have this T here and these were the free vacuum, then we would know how to evaluate these expectation values. So we understand the free Klein-Gordon theory. So we just, our basic strategy is going to be to relate our interacting fields and our interacting vacuum to the free case that we understand. And to do that, I'm going to introduce the interaction picture, which is a hybrid of the Schrodinger and Heisenberg pictures. So we want to write our full Hamiltonian of the theory we're interested in as the free Hamiltonian plus some interaction. So for the case we'll be interested in now, the free Hamiltonian will just be the Klein-Gordon Hamiltonian. And for the most part, I'll leave this unspecified, but occasionally I'll look at a particular example. So we could take this to be, for instance, the integral of lambda over 4 factorial phi to the fourth. So that's just a particular example of a perturbation we could make to our free Klein-Gordon theory, and we can think of this as a perturbation if this parameter lambda is small enough. And so we're going to, our strategy is going to be to evaluate these Green's functions, these endpoint functions, as a perturbation series in lambda. Okay. So I said the interaction picture is a hybrid of the Schrodinger picture and the Heisenberg picture. And so let me be a bit more precise with what I mean by that. So in the Schrodinger picture, our states evolve by the Schrodinger equation. Well, in the Heisenberg picture, the operators have time dependence. So a time-dependent operator in the Heisenberg picture is related to the Schrodinger picture operator by factors of e to the I h t and e to the minus I h t. And introduce a new notation for these factors. I'm going to call these U and U dagger. And we can think of these as time evolution operators. So they take a operator at t equals 0 and evolve it forward in time. OK, so these are what I'll refer to as time evolution operators. Probably can't read that. It's cramped. Let's rewrite this. So this is a time evolution operator. And the states in the Heisenberg picture are related to the states in the Schrodinger picture by this time evolution operator, e to the iht. So u dagger, this is u dagger of t0 psi s. Okay, so we're going to be going back and forth a lot between the Heisenberg and Schrodinger picture over the course of today's lecture. So I'll try to be clear at all times which picture we're working in. And so I said the interaction picture is a hybrid. So what do I mean by that? So the interaction picture, the operators evolve with the free Hamiltonian. So that means that the operator in the interaction picture is e to the I h naught t times the Schrodinger picture operator times e to the minus I h naught t. And the states evolve with the interaction Hamiltonian. And so that means that the state, just time dependent, in the interaction picture is e to the I h naught t psi of t in the Schrodinger picture. So I do mean h naught here, not h interaction. How is this consistent with this statement here that the states evolve with the interaction Hamiltonian? To see that, let's see what Schrodinger-like equation the interaction states satisfy, interaction picture and states satisfy. We can calculate that. As follows, so we take I ddt of, we just write down the Schrodinger equation. This is equal to h psi s. And we want to write down a version of this equation in the interaction picture. And so if we do that, the Schrodinger picture state is related to the interaction picture state by a factor of e to the minus h naught t. And the Schrodinger picture Hamiltonian, the total Hamiltonian is the sum of the free Hamiltonian and the interaction Hamiltonian. Then the same relation between the Schrodinger state and the interaction picture state. And so over here, we get two terms. So we get I ddt times, let's just do the derivative. We get I times minus I h naught e to the minus I h naught t psi I. The derivative hits the exponential, then we also get e to the minus I h naught t ddt psi I. And we can cancel off this term with this term. And we see that I and then multiply everything by e to the I h naught t. Get rid of this. And I can't do that. Yeah. we will multiply it, but that doesn't just cancel this. Sorry about that. Let me just write it on the next line. So here we have this on, and we have here e to the I h naught t h interaction e to the minus I h naught t psi I, and this is just what we call, this is just an operator evolved with the free Hamiltonian, which is the interaction picture interaction. So I'll denote this as HII. So this is the interaction picture interaction Hamiltonian. Okay. So that's what I mean when I say the states evolve with the interaction part of the Hamiltonian. Okay. So let's try to solve for the time evolution operator in the interaction picture. Okay. So what we want is to solve solve this equation, I ddt of ui of t and t naught equals h ii of t ui of t and t naught. Okay, so that's the equation we get if we just say that. Plug in that psi of t in the interaction picture is equal to u of t and t naught times psi of t naught. So this is the time evolution operator in the interaction picture. And if we plug this in here, we get this differential equation. So we want to solve. So the reason we're going to solve this, we want to solve this equation, is eventually we're going to relate the free vacuum to the interaction vacuum using this operator. So we'll get a nice formula that relates the two vacua that will allow us then to compute the endpoint Green's functions that we're interested in. Okay, so this looks like a simple enough equation. It's, you could almost guess that the solution is an exponential. There's a slight problem with this, though, right? Anyone see what it is? Right, so if these were just functions, it would be fine. But this is an operator equation. So this doesn't quite work. And let's see why. It's very close to the final, to the actual solution of this equation, but it doesn't work because if we expand out this exponential, we'll have some of these operators in the wrong order, and it won't actually solve that equation. So let me explain that in a bit more detail what goes wrong if we guess that this is the solution. Let's just plug it in and see what we get. So we get, we just compute the derivative of the exponential here. We get, so if we expand this out as a Taylor series in its argument, the first term is just 1. The next term is minus I times the integral t naught to t hii of t prime dt prime. And then we'll see the problem at this second order. So we can compute the derivative. This gives 0. Here we have a minus I hii of t. We get 2 terms over here. Minus I squared over 2. So if we hit the first one of these, we get hii of t integral t naught to t hii of t prime. If we get the second one, we get the same thing, just in the opposite order. And we can't resum this. So if we could commute this hi past this hi prime, then we'd be OK. And we'd have an hi out front, and we could resum everything else, get back the exponential that we started with. But we can't do that because these are operators. So this solution doesn't work. OK. So this is the problem term. Any questions so far? OK. So let's take a different approach. So we can directly integrate this equation. So we can write ui t and t naught as a constant minus I integral from t naught to t hii of t1 times ui of t1 to t naught dt1. So that's just taking the differential equation that u satisfies, integrating it once. And seems like if we iterate this many times, then we can get a recursive solution. So this gives us a recursive solution for UI, and we can solve this just by iteration. We can fix the constant, because remember, this is a time evolution operator. So we should have that if we evolve for no time, so UTT should equal 1. So if we evolve for no time, we're not changing our system. So this is because it's a time evolution operator. So we have this equation. So this constant equals 1. And we can iterate to find an expression for the time evolution operator. And that's just get a sum from n equals 0 to infinity minus I to the n integral from t naught to t dt1 integral from t naught to t1 dt2. Up to n, dtn, hi of t1 up to hii of tn. That's what we get if we just keep plugging in this solution. And one thing we notice about this is that these operators over here, h, are all time ordered because our t2 is between t0 and t1, and t3 is between t0 and t2, etc. So t1 here is the latest time. So these are already time ordered. Okay. Now we can use that to write this expression in a nicer way where we can resum the series. So to see that, let's look at, say, the second term. So let's look at the expression integral from t0 to t1, dt1, integral from t, t0, thanks. T0 to t, thanks. Yeah. dt1, t0 to t1, dt2, of the time ordering of hii of t1, hii of t2. And so we can write this as the integral. Sorry, I want these both to be t's. So these are both t's. I can write this as the integral. So there are two cases here. T1 could be greater than t2, or t2 could be greater than t1. So if t, so we're integrating in the t1, t2 plane over this square. T0 and this is T. And the time ordering will depend on which side of this line we're on. All right, so we're if we are here, then that means that T1 is greater than T2. If we're in this part of the triangle, then t2 is greater than t0. So we can write this as the integral from t0 to t dt1, integral from t0 to t1 dt2, hii of t1, hii of t2. Plus the integral from t0 0 to t dt2 integral from t0 to t2 dt1 h I of t2 h I of t1. So this is the bottom half of the square, and the other term is the top half of the square. But these two terms are the same. I've just relabeled t1 and t2. So that tells us that we can keep the time ordering in here because these things are already time ordered. We can change the limits in our expression up here at the cost, or at least for the second factor, at the cost of a factor of half. So that means that we can write ui of t and t naught as the sum from n equals 0 to infinity minus I over n factorial times the integral from t0 to t dt1 integral from t0 to t dtn, the time ordering of h ii of t1 up to h ii of tn. Okay. So we can do the same kind of trick where we extend the limits of integration, and we can write that in terms of n identical, n factorial identical terms like this. That correspond to the different ways of time ordering. Okay. So now we've ended up with something very close to what our initial guess was. So we can pull this time ordering symbol out front, because these are the only operators here. These are just integrating over a variable. And what we get when we do that is the sum is just an exponential. So we have this is equal to the time ordered exponential of minus I times integral from t0 to t dt prime hii of t prime. So this formula here is what's known as Dyson's formula. And we'll use this when we're computing the Green's functions. So this this formula we're going to use in just a minute to relate the interacting vacuum to the free vacuum. And because this involves our interaction Hamiltonian, which we assumed is small, if we want to compute things perturbatively, we can just compute a few of the terms in this series. But thus far, we've made no approximations. This is an exact formula. Yeah, and any questions about that? Yes. To find you, so in general, it's very hard to compute anything here exactly. There may be some special, if you don't have any symmetries, you're probably not going to be able to do any better than this. But there are, if you have a theory with a lot of symmetry, you might be able to make some exact statements. There are relatively few exact statements you can make in quantum field theory. Most of what we'll do is what you'll see in QFT1 and QFT2 is perturbative. Perhaps later in the year in standard model or other courses, we'll go into some of the non-perturbative methods. That's right. Yeah, you could also use numerical methods to solve this. Okay. So that's the time evolution operator. So,
it seems, I'm a little confused because it seems like there's nothing that we've done just now that's particular to quantum field theory. Why was this time ordering not a problem when we were doing non-relativistic mechanics?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So, we didn't assume anything really about that we're doing quantum field theory here instead of quantum mechanics.
Right. But like in like, you know, my undergrad courses, we never had to use a time ordering symbol in the unitary evolution.
Usually the Hamiltonian is time
independent. But even when it's, maybe I'm just remembering wrong. I mean, if we had a time dependent Hamiltonian, we would have had to put a time ordering symbol.
If you did have a time dependent Hamiltonian, you'd have to do something like this, yeah. Yeah. So the reason we had to go through this whole thing is because we didn't want to make the assumption that HII of T1 commuted with HII of T2. If that did commute, then we don't need this time ordering symbol.
I guess in undergraduate quantum mechanics, they'd never go beyond the form of the first term, the fixed function.
Yeah.
And the second order perturbation theory is usually known.
So for the example that I just erased, so there was some parameter, and we can treat this as a perturbation if that parameter is small. It was a dimensionless parameter if the parameter is small compared to 1. If you go in the opposite case, where our lambda, where this lambda becomes large compared to 1, then it's what's known as the strong coupling regime. And this is not a small perturbation to the Klein-Gordon Hamiltonian if lambda is large. And so in that case,
but you can still write it as H naught plus H int and derive all this. In that case,
nothing. Nothing here depended on the fact that this was a small perturbation. Some of the results we'll use in a few minutes will derive a relationship between the free vacuum and the interacting vacuum and.
So I guess my question is it always possible to write the Hamiltonian independently of whether the coupling parameter is big or small? Is it always possible to write your Hamiltonian as H naught plus H in for like?
Set H naught equals zero.
Yeah, but I mean,
who says that work?
I mean, for k cases that we care about? Is that do they pop up cases where?
If you want to do perturbation theory, it needs to be in some sense a small perturbation. So the most naive way will in general not necessarily if this is, we write the Klein-Gordon Hamiltonian plus this and lambda is large, then we can't think of this as a perturbation. There might be another description of the theory in which we could write an equivalent but different form of the Hamiltonian, which we can think of it as a free part plus a perturbation, but in general not. If the perturbation is big, then it's not the first few terms in this perturbation series that we'll derive is not necessarily a good approximation. This formula is exact. Not necessarily always useful, but it's exact. Okay. So, how do the fields behave in the interaction picture? So at fixed time, we can write the field in familiar form. And so if we go to the Heisenberg picture, before we assume that the fields took this form at when t naught was equal to 0, now we're just saying they take this form at some arbitrary time. So we might have to do some sort of redefinition compared to of the A's compared to if we demanded that this hold when t equals 0. So in the Heisenberg picture, it's related to the expression I wrote above as e to the I h t minus delta t minus t naught phi of t naught and x e to the minus I h t minus t naught. And I'll denote t minus t naught as delta t. And so we can write this as just multiplying and dividing by the same thing. We multiply here by e to the minus I h naught delta t, here by e to the I h naught delta t. So this is just 1 phi of t naught x. And then do the same thing over here, but multiply by first e to the minus I h naught delta t, then by e to the plus I h naught delta t. And we have the e to the I h delta t that we started with. Okay, so we've just here multiplied by 1 on both sides once. And the reason we've done that is because now we can identify this as phi I. So we said that operators in the interaction picture transform with the free Hamiltonian. And so this is our interaction picture field. And this here is the dagger of the time evolution operator we just computed. And this is the time evolution operator we just computed, ui of t and t naught. So to see that, let's check that it satisfies the same equation. That the time evolution operator we calculated satisfies. So if we compute I ddt e to the I h naught t e to the minus I ht, this is e to the I h naught t. Because h naught commutes with itself, we can put the h naught IH naught we get on either side of this e to the IH naught t. So we'll put it on the right over here. And on the left, when we act with the derivative on this term. And this is just H interaction in the Schrodinger picture. Which is, if we break this up, or insert the identity here, you can write this as I H naught T H int H e to the minus I H naught T e to the plus I H naught T e to the minus I h t. And this is just the interaction Hamiltonian in the interaction picture. And then this is what we called ui. So these are the same thing. So this is what we just computed. Okay. So we've done a lot of hard work deriving this formula. And so now let's put it to use. Our motivation at the beginning was we wanted to divide things up this way so that we could compute these endpoint Green's functions. And since we don't know that much about the interacting vacuum, let's try to understand that by looking at the time evolution of the free vacuum. Okay.
So how does the operators in the interaction picture evolve? Do they evolve via, because the formula you wrote in that board up there, the left hand side is phi in the Heisenberg.
Mm-hmm.
The right-hand side is phi in the interaction picture with the unitary evolution operator.
So in the interaction picture, our time evolution operator is what we just computed, this
right.
UI. Is that what you were asking?
Yeah, but that guy is going to evolve the states.
That evolves the states, right.
Yeah, but how evolution is not given by that operator?
No. So we know how the Heisenberg, how the operators evolve in the Heisenberg picture. And so we wrote down this equation. Yeah. So here we have the interaction picture fields. This is the time evolution operator in the interaction picture. This is the Heisenberg thing. So we could write this.
So I guess what I'm trying to say is that we'll have to plug that into the Heisenberg equation of motion.
That's right.
From there, we find out how phi actually changes.
That's right. We won't use that yet, but that's how you would do that. Okay. So we want to understand the interacting vacuum. And to do that, our goal is to understand the interacting vacuum. And to do that, let's look at this expression here. E to the I H T plus T naught acting on the free vacuum. So we can write this as e to the I h t plus t naught, and then insert the identity here in the form of a complete set of states. So we'll write the identity as the interacting vacuum plus a sum over all of the other states. So here, what I mean by this sum integral sign is, so all the other states be specified by some discrete parameters and some continuous parameters. So for instance, if we have a two-particle state, we need to specify that there are two particles. They have some total momentum, which is a continuous parameter, and some relative momentum, which is also a continuous parameter.
I don't want to throw you off track, but I need to go back to what you said for a second.
Okay.
Aren't the fields are operators, right?
That's right.
So, but in the second line on the top board, you're evolving them using the full Hamiltonian. Whereas earlier, I thought we said that the operators evolve with just the free Hamiltonian.
The interaction picture operators evolve with.
And this is phi h.
Yeah. So So the top line there, that's at a fixed time. The phi h is the Heisenberg picture. Phi I is the interaction picture. So that relates. That the equation we have
this is relating phi h to phi I. It's not itself related to phi. Okay.
But if we wanted to, so.
I want to just have the the time evolution of phi I on its own.
Yeah. So
relative to phi I at time zero, it's evolving just with.
Just with the free part of the Hamiltonian. Okay. That's right. That's right. Okay. Any other questions before I continue? So here, this H is the total Hamiltonian. Or the Schrodinger picture. Yeah. Okay. So why? So here we have the interacting vacuum here. So we assume that we've divided, chosen these other states so that these are eigenstates of the full Hamiltonian, we can make some progress. And so what we get is that this is just E naught T plus T naught times omega, omega times overlap of omega with zero, plus the sum integral for the other states of e to the minus I en t plus t naught. So here, what I mean by E naught is just the energy eigenvalue of the interacting vacuum. And we're assuming that the eigenvalue, the energy eigenvalue under the free Hamiltonian of the free vacuum is zero. And so if this is omega is the vacuum of the interacting theory, then all of these other states should have a greater energy than E naught. So we have En is greater than E naught for all. Minus, yes, thank you. Okay, so we're almost there. So we can then use this equation to, so we can solve this for omega in terms of zero, right? This is just a number. This is just a number. So we can solve this equation for omega and get an equation that relates our interacting vacuum to the free vacuum. So if we do that, that omega is equal to e to the minus I h t plus t naught, 0, divided by e to the minus I e naught t plus t 0, omega 0 minus 1 over omega 0, sum integral n non-zero, e to the minus I, e n minus e naught, t plus t naught, n 0. So notice for this to work, we need there to be a non-zero overlap between the interacting vacuum and the free vacuum. And if our interaction Hamiltonian is a small perturbation, then that's a reasonable assumption. So if they had zero overlap, we're making a big perturbation. And perturbation theory is probably not a good way to study properties of omega. OK, so what can we do with this? This is a mess, and it doesn't seem to tell us a whole lot. But if we take the limit if t goes to infinity in a slightly imaginary direction, then this term will go to 0. So we know that En is greater than E0. So if we look at the evolve for a long time, then these terms will not contribute. So these terms go to 0. Alternatively, we could think they oscillate faster if we take t to 0 and didn't make anything imaginary, and so they would their contribution would go to 0 faster than this term. So if we look at just the late time limit, only this first term survives. That's right. Yeah, so we want to, so I've taken it, the imaginary part here to be slightly negative, which means that, so if there's a small negative imaginary part to t, then the overall exponential here is negative because En is greater than E0. This is not the only way we could see this. Yeah, there's other ways, but yeah, it's simplest. Any other questions? So, we note that the numerator here is just e to the I h t plus t naught, which is just our evolution operator in the originally defined in the Heisenberg picture. So this is the signs are t naught and minus t. So this is this. And since we've chosen our free Hamiltonian so that h naught is equal to 0, we also have that e to the I h naught t acting on 0 is equal to 0. So u of t naught t minus t acting on 0 is equal to ui of t naught minus t acting on 0, because these are just related by a factor of e to the iht. H naught t plus t naught. So we can move to the interaction picture here. And what we get is our final expression for the interacting vacuum. It's the limit as T goes to infinity, 1 minus I epsilon times UI of T naught minus T, 0 over e to the minus I e naught T plus T naught times the overlap between omega and 0. And the bra is given by a very similar formula. And if you think about which direction you need to take things in to get rid of the other terms, you'll find that the formula takes a very similar form. It's just 0 ui t and t naught over e to the minus I e naught t minus t naught 0 omega. Okay. So we're now what have we done? So we've related the interacting vacuum to the time evolution of the free vacuum. So we've related these to basically infinite. If we start in the free vacuum and time evolve for long enough and divide by this normalization factor, we'll end up in the interacting vacuum. So we can use this then to, because we can relate this to our interaction Hamiltonian with Dyson's formula. So we can put this together to relate the Green's functions we're interested in to Green's functions we know how to compute. Because we know how to compute expectation values of products of fields sandwiched between the states zero, the bra and ket zero, with a free vacuum. So now that we can relate the interacting vacuum to the free vacuum, together with this time evolution operator, which we can write to our interaction Hamiltonian, which is, we can in turn relate to the interaction picture fields, we can compute the Green's functions we're interested in. So let's see how that works. Done most of the hard work already. So let's look at an example, see how this works. So let's look at the two-point function. And let's assume that x naught is greater than y naught, it's greater than t naught. For simplicity. So let's call this gxy. So gxy is equal to just using our results. It's the late time limit, so limit t goes to infinity times 1 minus I epsilon. We have these factors of e to the minus I e naught t plus t naught omega 0 1 over e to the minus I E naught T minus T naught 0 omega. And then we have 0 UI of T T naught. That just comes from the bra up there. Then we can write phi of x in terms of the phi, in terms of the interaction picture. So phi of x is equal, so remember the Heisenberg picture is equal to u dagger times the interaction picture times u times the time evolution operator in the interaction picture. That was what we derived up there, the bottom equation on the top board. So using that relation, we get here u dagger I x naught t naught phi I of x u I x naught t naught times u I dagger y naught t naught phi I y of u I y naught t naught u I of t naught minus t. Okay, so it's kind of a mess, but there's a lot of simplifications that go on here. Right, so remember that UI is a time evolution operator. And so we have things like this expression here, which says first evolve, time evolve from minus t to t naught, and then evolve from t naught to y naught. So that's just the same thing as time evolving from minus t all the way to y naught. So this factor all simplifies. And u dagger is basically just backwards time evolution. So this thing, this factor here says evolve from x naught to t naught, and then from t naught to t. So all these factors sandwich together. And what we're left with after the dust clears is much simpler than this expression we have here. So this will all collapse. These will collapse like this, and I'll write it down in a minute. This prefactor, there's also a lot of cancellation that goes on here. So to see that, can write the identity that 1 is equal to the norm of omega, which is, using our formulas from up here, 1 over omega 0 squared e to the 2 minus 2i e naught t times 0 ui t t naught ui t naught minus t 0. Okay. So we take this together with the fact that these time evolution operators all telescoped down together. We can write a simpler expression. And what we get is, this is almost our final form. Zero times ui of t x naught phi I of x u I of x naught y naught phi I y u y naught t zero, and on the bottom we have zero ui of t and minus t, zero. Okay. And so now, so the right-hand side of this equation is already time-ordered. So we can put in a time-ordering operator here for free. And we're free now to take the limit that t goes to infinity. So what we get when we do that last one, is this is equal to zero times the time ordered product phi I of x phi I of y times the exponential of minus I dt hi I of t, zero, divided by zero times the time ordered exponential of minus I integral from minus infinity dt hi I of t, zero. So this is our final expression. So that was a lot of work. What have we learned? So we've related, in this last step, I used the fact that we already computed ui to be just the time-ordered exponential of the interaction Hamiltonian. So what have we learned? We've related this endpoint or two-point function in this case, but it works in general. If we had n fields here, we would just get n fields over here inside this time-ordered product. So we've related the endpoint function with the interacting vacuum to a, we've traded this interacting vacuum for these factors of the exponential of the interaction Hamiltonian. This is a big simplification because phi I, remember, was just to the interaction picture fields, as Tirbo asked about earlier, it's just related to the Schrodinger picture through the time evolution with the free Hamiltonian. So these are free fields. And we know how to compute expectation, or we'll learn how to compute expectation values of time-ordered products of free fields which is much with the free vacuum, which is much easier than dealing with this side over here, where we don't even have a nice closed expression for what this state is, and how the creation and annihilation operators act on this state. So we know how the creation and annihilation operators act on the vacuum, so we are much more likely to be able to compute things over here. And final thing to note is that so the interaction Hamiltonian in the interaction picture is related. So let's suppose the interaction Hamiltonian is just integral d3x of, say, lambda over 4 factorial phi to the fourth in the Heisenberg picture. Let's write it in the Schrodinger picture. So this, because the Schrodinger picture fields are just related to the interaction picture fields by time evolution with the free Hamiltonian, this means that the interaction Hamiltonian in the interaction picture is given by the same function of the interaction picture fields. So the difference between this and this is just that phi I is equal to e to the I h naught t phi s e to the minus I h naught t. So we have four products. Most of these will just cancel off in pairs. And we're left with one extra on the outside that's just the difference between the interaction picture, interaction Hamiltonian, and the interaction Hamiltonian in the Schrodinger picture. Okay. So if we want to compute this, we can just do a perturbative expansion. So this exponential is given, is defined in terms of its power series. And so if we treat if the interaction picture, interaction Hamiltonian, is controlled by some small parameter lambda, we can approximate this by just the first few terms in the Taylor series of this exponential. So that means what we really need to learn how to compute, if we want to compute this right-hand side, is so what have we gained? So we started out wanting to compute this. And now, using the formula we just derived, we see that all we need to compute to find this, we need to compute time-ordered products of fields with the free vacuum, sandwiched between the free vacuum instead of the interacting vacuum, with some terms that come from the times h I. So all these are in the interaction picture. sums of powers of this. But if HII is an integral of products of fields, then really all we need to know how to compute is time-ordered products of fields. So if there weren't this time ordering, we already know how to do it. So the only thing we need to worry about is how to compute these things. What is it? How does this time ordering affect things? So any questions on that? So that's the interaction picture. And then we'll learn how to compute these time-ordered products with the free vacuum from there. That's the main result. Can you repeat that? Oh, so I originally said that all we need to compute is 0 times the time ordering product of phi 1 up to phi n. And Tom asked about HII. But if HII is made up of products, then all we really need to compute is 0 t phi 1 up to phi n 0. So that's our goal. If we compute that, then we can compute the green functions, omega t phi 1 up to phi n omega, which we need to then go back and compute what we're really interested in, which is the scattering amplitude, FII. So we made some simplification, and we'll be able to compute this product, this expectation value 0 t phi 1 through phi n 0 using Wick's theorem. And so I'm not going to have time to go through all of it today, but I just want, I'll start that and we'll continue that tomorrow. Yes.
So with the quantum limit, how do we know that this term is blowing up?
Which term?
The only one that's left.
The only one that's left. That's right. We could worry that this term blows up. Eventually, we got rid of that factor of e to the I e naught t. So if there's an infinity there, it cancels in a controlled way. So so we related. So we had this thing was equal to 1. So we related this this thing, which could blow up in this late time limit, to this. This became our denominator.
You can explain the argument of the dt function over 1 minus I epsilon.
OK. So what we might expect is that the vacuum state is what we'll end up with, no matter what state we start in, if we wait long enough. All right. So that's kind of why we were doing what we were doing. We took a state that we expected had some overlap with the true vacuum and just waited long enough. But if we take the limit t goes to infinity without this imaginary part, everything here just oscillates wildly. So it's not clear what's happening. But if we put in a small imaginary part, we see that this is the term that really matters, because if it has a small negative imaginary part, then there'll be a negative real number in this exponent. And this will go to zero fastest in this limit. I think there's also a way to do this without making time imaginary using the Riemann-Lebesgue lemma. The Riemann-Lebesgue lemma, I think you can make some argument using that as well.
So this was exactly the free of the lemma, right? It was for every T, big
T? Yes. Yeah. The only assumption we made was that this was not zero. Which if our perturbation H int was not a small perturbation, then this if it was a large perturbation, then this could be zero. It would be possible. But if it's a small perturbation, we expect this is non-zero, that the interacting vacuum is in some sense close to the free vacuum. Okay. So started a little bit late, so I'm just going to go for about 5 more minutes, and I just want to state Wick's theorem, and we'll discuss it a bit more tomorrow. Okay. So Wick's theorem. So what we're trying to compute is this. And so I'm going to drop the I's from now on. All of our fields are going to be in the interaction picture from now on, but I'm not going to indicate that. And so how can we compute this? So it's useful to break up our field into positive and negative frequency parts. So here by 5 plus, I mean integral d3p over 2 pi cubed 2ep ap e to the minus I p dot x. So this part creates has all of the annihilation operators, and phi minus has all of the creation operators. And so this minus and plus sign is a little bit confusing compared to the signs over here, but 70 or 80 years of tradition mandate this choice. So the reason we want to break things up this way is because we know how the creation and annihilation operators act on the vacuum. So if we break things up this way, and then time order the phi plus and phi minus, we can think about what we need to commute in order to get all the annihilation operators to the right and the creation operators to the left. Same way we had before. So if x naught is greater than y naught, we can do that. We can compute the time ordering of 5x, 5y. As just 5x, 5y, which is phi plus of x plus phi minus of x times phi plus of y plus phi minus of y And so what we really want to do is relate the time ordering to the normal ordering. Because after things are normal ordered, we know that when we sandwich a normal ordered operator between the free vacuum, we get zero. Because normal ordering means all the creation operators to the left, all the annihilation operators are to the right. So there's only one term here we need to worry about. And that is the first term is fine. So phi plus x, phi plus of y is fine. That's already normal ordered. The term phi minus y, phi plus of x. So this term has the creation operators to the right, the annihilation operators to the left. But that's not what we would get if we just expanded this out. So in order to get these things in this order, we need to add a commutator. But all of the rest of the terms are fine. So that's the only term we get if we just expand out this time-ordered product that's not already normal ordered. So our other terms are OK. And we get exactly the same thing if we start with if we time order these operators where y naught is greater than x naught, except for in that case, we would need the opposite commutator. Because in that case, it's basically just relabeling x and y. So what we get is that the time order product of phi of x, phi of y is equal to theta of x naught minus y naught, phi plus of x, phi minus of y, plus theta of y naught minus x naught, phi plus of y, phi minus of x. Plus, yeah. And so this expression should look familiar to you from before. So this is what we found was the Feynman propagator. So this is equal to the Feynman propagator. And we can also denote this what I mean over here is the time ordered, sorry, this should be the time ordered product of phi of x, phi of y minus the normal ordered product. Is this? And so a convenient notation is to call this phi of x contracted with phi of y. And So this is how things work for two fields. And I'll just end with a statement of the general case, and we'll discuss it tomorrow. So the general case is what's known as Wick's theorem. So Wick's theorem says that the time-ordered product of phi 1 up to phi n is equal to the normal-ordered product of phi 1 up to phi n plus the normal ordering of all possible contractions. And so what I mean by contraction of fields is when we draw a line between them, that means we're contracting the fields. And the contraction of two fields is equal to the Feynman propagator. And so all possible contractions here includes partially contracted combinations of fields. And so Wick's theorem allows us to take time-ordered products of fields and convert them to normal-ordered products of fields plus Feynman propagators. And so we know now all of the ingredients we need to compute these time-ordered products, which we need in order to compute the time-ordered products with the interacting vacuum, which we need to compute the scattering amplitudes. So we now have all the ingredients. And tomorrow, we'll put them all together and see how to compute scattering amplitudes. Any questions? Yes. So contraction of two fields is equal to the Feynman propagator. And we indicate it with this line between the fields. Any other questions? So here we said that the time-ordered product of 5x, 5y is equal, so here I move this term over to the other side, is equal to the normal-ordered product. And there's only one way to contract two fields. So. No, this is in dots. Okay, I'll see you tomorrow.